Welcome to my channel. So, in the today's lecture, we are going to discuss concurrency in transaction. What does concurrency mean in transaction? So, in the today's world, most of the people are doing online transactions. Okay, most of the people are doing online transactions. Even if you have to purchase some item from the Flipkart, at the one particular point of time, lots of people are doing online payment. Okay, by using debit card or credit card. So, at a one particular point of time, lot of people are doing online transactions. They are transferring money from their accounts to the Flipkart's account. Okay, so let's assume that at a one particular point of time, five people are doing online payment. You know, when you purchased some item from the Flipkart, now you are doing online payment. When you are doing online payment, at the same time, there are many number of people in the country or in the world are doing the online payment. So, let's suppose five people are doing online payment at a one particular point of time. Let's suppose at 10:30 a.m. Okay, at 10:30 a.m. five people are transferring money from their account to the Flipkart's account. So we are having five transactions. Okay, we are having five transactions which we have to process. All these transactions wants to execute at a one particular point of time. Okay, so it really depends how many number of CPU you are using. In most of the cases, we are having only one CPU. Okay, as we have five number of transactions to be executed at a one particular point of time, we will be executing only one transaction at a time. Because we have only one CPU and we can process only one transaction at a time. Okay, so what you can do? We have to speed up the execution of all these five transactions. Okay, so first condition is what I am doing. I am arranging all these transactions in a serial order. I just say that I will be executing all these five transactions in this order. First, second, third, fourth and fifth. Okay, so when your first transaction is getting executed, when your first transaction is getting executed, all these four users are in a line. They are waiting for their transaction to be processed. Okay? Their transaction has not been processed. They are waiting in line. So, when your transaction one has been executed completely, now you are moving to transaction T2. You will execute all of the instructions present in this transaction T2. Okay, but we have a drawback using this kind of execution. Okay, if we are going to execute all these transactions serially, then your users has to wait for a long period of time. If you look at this fifth user, it has to wait unless all these by day. We don't want any waiting. We want our transactions to be processed as fast as possible. Okay, even if you want to open a google.com and it is taking 5 minutes or it is taking 2 to 3 minutes to open google.com, then it is a poor, we can say it is a poor network connection. We don't, you know, like waiting. We want to execute whatever we want as fast as possible. Okay, so in this case, the waiting time of users is very high. User has to wait for a long amount of time. So we don't prefer to execute multiple transactions serially, one by one. Okay, so how we can speed up the execution of multiple transactions? We are going to execute multiple transactions in a concurrent manner. What does concurrency mean? Concurrency means parallelly. Okay, we are going to execute all the transactions parallelly. Okay, so let's suppose I have 4 instructions written in this transaction, and I also have 4 instructions written in this transaction. So how I will be executing multiple transactions concurrently? Firstly, I am executing transaction T1. I am not executing this transaction completely. I am just executing some of the instructions of this transaction. Suppose I executed first 2 instructions of this transaction. Now, what I will be doing? I will be moving to the transaction T2. Okay, because we have to reduce the waiting time of the users. We just want users to wait for a less amount of time. That's why we are doing context switching. We are doing a kind of switching between multiple transactions. Then I am moving to transaction T2. I am executing some of the instructions of this transaction T2. Then again, I am switching back to this transaction T1. Okay, so we are doing switching between the transactions so that we can reduce the waiting time of the users. Okay, it is not that your users don't have to wait in this concurrent execution of the transaction, but in this case the response time is very less for the users. The users will get first time response very faster in this case. Okay, so let me give you an example. It's a real life example. Let's suppose I want to open Google Chrome browser in my PC. Okay, so what I am doing, I click on the Google Chrome. debit or credit card on the Flipkart. Okay, so we are having two transactions here. My first transaction is going to be, we are reading the amount of Aarti's balance from the database. Okay, let's consider one database. We have a database, let's suppose account detail. Let's suppose we have account number, name and balance. Okay, 1, 2, 3, name Aarti. Let's suppose balance is 20,000. Account number 2, 3, 4, let's suppose name is Neha. She has a balance amount of 30,000. 4, 5, 6. Let's suppose this is account number of Flipkart. Let's suppose 50,000 is present in the amount of Flipkart. Okay. So I want to transfer money from Aarti's account to Flipkart as well as from Neha's account to Flipkart's account. Okay. Both are happening at the same time. Both these online payments are happening at the same time. So let's suppose I read money of Aarti's balance and I am transferring. Let's suppose I purchased some item of rupees 5,000. So I am subtracting that money from my account and I am updating here. Okay, similarly, I am reading the Flipkart balance and I am adding 5,000 Flipkart balance. Then I am writing at the Flipkart balance. Okay, similarly, I have a second transaction in which I am transferring 5,000 money from Neha's account to the Flipkart's account. So we are reading Neha balance. So I am subtracting 5,000 amount from Neha's balance. Okay. Now I want to update value here. Okay. This operation we are performing in the main memory. And we want to reflect this change in the database also. So what I am going to do, I am going to write here like this. Read Flipkart. Okay. And I am adding 5,000 in the Flipkart balance. And I am writing in the Flipkart. Okay. So these are the two transactions. Both are happening at the same time. Okay. So, if I have to execute these two transactions, simultaneously. Okay. So, what are the problems we might face? So, if you look at, we are transferring in this transaction 5,000 rupees from Aarti's balance to the Flipkart balance, and in this transaction we are transferring 5,000 rupees from Neha's balance to the Flipkart balance. Okay, so I want to execute both these transactions simultaneously at a one time. Okay, so if I execute both these transactions serially, then there is no problem. Okay, we can easily execute them. But what is the problem? Problem arises when we execute both these transactions parallelly. Okay, so we have to context switch between both these transactions. Okay, so let me tell you how we can face problems while executing the transactions concurrently. Let's suppose initially I executed Okay. So whatever operations we have been performing till now, first of all, I am reading balance amount of 40. I am deducting 5,000 rupees from it, and I am performing the update operation in the database. Okay, so I am making here 15,000. I am making here 15,000. And at this operation, what I am doing? I am reading the balance amount of Flipkart. It is actually 50,000. Okay, so now I am switching from this transaction to transaction T2. Okay, so what I am doing? Firstly, I am reading the Neha's balance. I am subtracting 5,000 rupees from the Neha's balance. Okay, then I am updating the Neha balance. So I am making here 25,000. Okay, then I am performing this operation. Read Flipkart's balance. What is the value here? 50,000. I am reading it in the main memory. Okay, I read this value and I am saving this value in the main memory. Okay, now again I am switching to transaction T1. Okay, so how you will be performing switching between the transactions? You can set clock for that. Then for this amount of time, this transaction should run, and after that time period, you will be switching to some next transaction. Okay. So now I am running this operation. Flipkart equal to Flipkart plus 5,000. Okay, whatever value I read of Flipkart balance, I am adding 5,000 rupees into it. Okay, and I am writing this value in the Flipkart's balance. So what is going to be my value here? 55,000. And I am writing this value in the Flipkart balance amount in the database. I am updating here. So I am changing here from 50,000 to 55,000. Okay. So now I am switching to this transaction. I have executed all of the instructions of this transaction. Okay. Now I am moving to this transaction. So what I am going to do? I am going to add 5,000 rupees in the Flipkart's balance. Okay. I write the value this 50,000 from the database last time. Okay. So I am going to add 5,000 rupees to this 50,000 amount. Okay. So what is going to be my amount now? 55,000. Okay. So I want to now update this change in the database. Whatever operations I have done here, I want to reflect the change in the database. So I am performing the write operation. Okay, I am writing this value 55,000 in the database. Whatever value is present in the database, you are changing the value to 55,000. You are updating old value with new value. Okay, so in this case, if you look at 55,000 is going to be the final value here. But is this right? You know, I transferred 5,000 rupees from Aarti's account to Flipkart, and I transferred 5,000 from Neha's account to Flipkart's account. So the actual amount should be in the Flipkart account is 60,000. Okay, but what I am getting here? I am getting here 55,000. So we are getting loss of 5,000 rupees. Okay, so these kind of problems we are facing in the concurrency. Why these problems are coming? Because get loss. Okay, if in both the transactions we are working on a different database value, then you execute transactions in any manner. Okay, you can execute all the transactions in any manner. But when multiple transactions are working on the same database value, like your Flipkart balance, then we have to follow some set of conditions. We have to follow some set of rules so that we can avoid such kind of problems like profit or loss. Because we are dealing with money and we want the exact amount. We don't want any kind of profit or loss. Now, when we are dealing with money, it is a very important matter. And we cannot allow any kind of increment or any kind of decrement here. Okay, so we need to take care of it. We have to avoid such kind of problems which are coming in the concurrency. Okay, so what we could do? How we can handle this kind of situation? If both the transactions are using the same database value, then how could we resolve this kind of problem? If you execute it completely. Okay? If you execute it completely, then you execute it completely. Okay? Whatever change this transaction wants to perform, if it has done its change, then if you are running all this set of instructions, then we could avoid this kind of problem. Okay, so we will be discussing various protocols with the help of which we will get to know that how we can sort out the problems coming while concurrency. We cannot stop multiple transactions to not use the same database value. Okay, they will definitely use the same database value. In this example, you can see that it really happens in the real life. So we cannot stop multiple transactions to not use the same database value. But the question is, if multiple transactions are using the same database value, then how we have to handle such kind of transactions? Okay, so that we can get the right output without having any profit or loss. I hope that you are clear with this concept. So if you have any query, I have mentioned my email ID in the description box. You can contact me on that email ID. So if you like my video, please like, share and subscribe my channel.